Of course, it was the part of James Bond that brought Sean Connery fame, riches, and good reviews. And his decision to return to the part in Never Say Never Again brought him greater fame, more riches, and even better reviews. But I admire him most for his courageous decision 12 years ago to shed the comfortable overcoat of the ruthless 007 and to attempt to forge a career as a more serious actor. The Bond image then was a positive hindrance, and the result was that some of those early post-Bond films were frankly rather dull. But Connery overcame the burden of Bond to become one of our major actors.
Sean Connery was born in Edinburgh during the Depression on the 25th of August 1930. He left school at 13 and tried a variety of jobs, including coffin polishing, a milkman, a steelworker, and an able seaman in the Navy. But it was his hobby, bodybuilding, that laid the cornerstone of his acting career. While he was in London to compete in the 1953 Mr. Universe contest, he auditioned successfully for a part in the hit stage musical South Pacific. From then on, he appeared in small television roles until he got his first lead as the prize fighter in the television production of Requiem for a Heavyweight in 1957. A seven-year contract with 20th Century Fox followed, and he appeared in a series of rarely remarkable films that did little for his career. But then along came Bond. Dr. No in 1961 was followed by five more James Bond films, all equally successful. When he finally cast off the part, he matured into a confident, often compelling actor, appearing in such movies as The Offence, The Hill, Robin and Marion, and 5 Days, One Summer, and finally returning to the part of Bond in the ironically titled Never Say Never Again.
I hate the words exclusive interview because they never are, and Connery's been talking to the press of late. But he is an infuriatingly private man, and it's rare for him to come out and talk in front of an audience, as he does at the National Film Theatre tonight.
Welcome to the NFT. Were you pleased that they decided to run a season of your films?
Absolutely thrilled. My God, it's a bit like the Inquisition here.
It is written in the press already that it was your wife, Micheline, who invited you, suggested that you return to the role of James Bond. How did she do it? Where were you, and what did she say?
Well, it's a sort of convoluted story, but it goes back a while when I was doing The Wind and the Lion. Kevin McClory came and he knew I had no desire to play the part, but wanted me to write the script with Len Deighton. I agreed to do it, and it was going rather well, and I told Micheline, and she said, well, if it's going so well, why don't you play the part? And when I thought about it, well, it seemed quite a good idea. Thought it through and then decided to go ahead.
I came down to the set one day, and I think it would be true to say that Irvin Kershner got some assistance from you on the days when you were on the set in terms of direction. You have no qualms about that. You don't bow down to the auteur director.
Well, I think that in the case of the Bond films, I've done now done seven, and that was his first. I think that... That if McClory had asked me to come in and do some writing on the film with Len Deighton, it was primarily because I've had experience in six previous ones. And after all, it's 13 years since I had played the Bond part, and in that interim period, I've well, learned a few wrinkles too.
There's a whole host of writers, McClory himself and his partner and Deighton. The credit goes to Lorenzo Semple Jr. on the film, but I know other people worked on it, didn't they? Why should one man be attributed the final screenplay when perhaps it wasn't one man's final screenplay?
Well, on that issue, I feel it's grossly unfair because, in fact, Lorenzo Semple came up with a basic structure at the beginning, and I worked with him to get the construction of the story right within the confines of the limitations of the legal department, which were rather important. And having got that, it's like a stage A and then the stage B. The second stage was to be able to get the dialogue right. Unfortunately, Lorenzo was is American. I don't mean that in a disrespectful way, but I mean it's basically the humor is very British. And with an American director and an American writer, it is a tendency to go towards American humor. And we were fortunate in being able to get Ian Lafreny and Dick Clement, who I, sorry to say, have no credit on the film and should have, because their contribution, the film would be zilch without it. And they pulled it back. We worked a lot on different scenes and got the humor back more on a sort of British basis.
Yes, there's a lovely line in it. Alec McCown plays Q, and he says, "Now that you're on the case, Mr. Bond, I hope we're going to have some gratuitous sex and violence."
Yeah, I like that too, because... no.
But the time-honored formula perhaps dictates the story more than anything else, does it really, in terms of what you expect the box office will... where the appetite will be created?
Well, no, I don't agree with what you're saying at all. The point is that the film itself, they were already taking a different direction during the You Only Live Twice, going on to Diamonds Are Forever. Mm-hmm. And when I left it, then when Roger inherited the part, they were already going in the direction with the Hardware. My feeling is that the better of the films was From Russia With Love. And so when I was going to be involved in the picture coming back, whatever the risk factor was going to be, whether I was too old, too bald, too fat, too Scottish, too whatever, that I was going to at least pull it back into the direction of where there were people who one would be interested in. And therefore one aimed at getting what I thought was the best actors mm-hmm. possible for all the different parts. And making a story, hopefully, that an audience would follow, regardless of whether it was a James Bond film or not.
I mean, the most interesting of the casting was Klaus Marie Brandauer, who'd been known primarily to Western audiences from his performance as Mephisto, which I think got him an Oscar.
Yeah.
You know, the film did, best foreign film. I spoke to him during the filming of Never Say Never Again, and he said that in previous Bond films he'd seen, villains were black. He didn't believe people were black, they were grey. And it was quite a courageous approach to a part, wasn't it? He plays Largo, who is your main adversary. But in fact, there's a twinkle in his eyes. He's not someone who's just out for ultimate death, is he?
No, I mean, that's why it was so important to get somebody. Once you have that caliber of actor, you start to get a whole different context of movie. You get a different fabric, you get a whole different relative relationship with everybody in the film. He, for example, is like the perennial con man. You have to believe in him, and I think he's one of the 10 best actors, and certainly in Europe anyway.
You must be Mr. James Bond, right?
Monsieur Largo.
Yes, right. Are you a man who enjoys games?
Depends with whom I'm playing.
Yeah, shall we? Join us. These are my friends. They honored me by coming from all over the world to lose their money for my favorite charity.
And what might that be?
Children, orphan children. So, here we are. The game is called Domination. I designed it myself. But my problem is I've never yet found a worthy adversary.
No doubt I shall disappoint you too.
We'll see. Darling, this game has one objective, power.
When you meet Americans who've seen not only this film, but your previous six and some others by other people, do they see Bond as quintessentially English, or do they see him as you say, someone from traditional tragedy or traditional drama?
Well, I don't know how English he is. I mean, I'm from Edinburgh myself.
They are said to speak. I wish I had an answer to that. But you yourself, when you left Scotland, from not a rich family, was it really, did you escape from Scotland into what became a part in the chorus of South Pacific? Was it a means of escape, or was it a piece of ambition, saying, this is what I want to do, I want to act?
No, it's just, I mean... It's one sees things a bit clearer, even in an actor's career, in retrospect, the same as I do in my life. And I remember that my ambition was to finish with school, to get into the Navy, to go to the war. I don't know why, but whether it was propaganda or whatever, but I wanted just to get out of wherever I was, as it were, in Scotland. And just as soon as I possibly could, I went to the Navy and achieved ulcers and was out after 3 years. So much for ambition, but the drive was still to get out of the place. I came back to Scotland and I still wanted to get out. And it seems to be a very common case. A lot of Scots are the same. Mm. There's 5 million of them and there still stays 5 million, and no matter what happens, and there's 14 million in America. And in fact, I didn't really decide or had any decision to be an actor until I was, after 1 year on tour. I'd done 3 months at Drury Lane Theatre, and then I was on tour for a year and all over Scotland, England, Ireland, Wales. And it was only when I was faced with the possibility of another tour for another year, and I was playing soccer in Manchester, they had said, well, would you consider to take a trial for soccer professionally, that I really had to make a decision. And an actor in the company called Robert Henderson said to me, well, why didn't, I thought you'd be serious about being an actor. I'd never really considered it before. And I talked it through with him. So it was really the first person in my life I had, I would think, a genuine guidance from in a sense of a direction.
Yes, because from him perhaps you obtained a sort of sentimental education. I mean, what someone else might have obtained at drama school or some form of university, didn't he encourage you to read?
Yeah, well, I went to school at nine, went to school at five, I left school at 13. So, and that was during the war years, 39 the war started, 43 I finished with that. So I had no basic education as such, because during the heavy period, 42, 43 onwards, we were in people's houses, and a lot of people didn't want certain kids in their houses, and I was one of them. And so,
why was that?
Well, because it's okay to deliver the milk, and it's not the same to go in and be taught. And so I was always very conscious of the fact that one did not have formal education as such, and was greatly impressed when I was on tour in South Pacific with actors and writers and directors that seemed so brilliant and seemed to know everything, and I thought I was so stupid, and just over-impressed by them all. And as I've got older, because I'm very old now, I'm 53, I realized that they weren't so smart, you know? And but it was a great hurdle for me to overcome. And then this sentimental education, as you want to call it, by taking on a year in the libraries in Great Britain, I went through a whole course in literature, from all the Shaws, Shakespeare, War and Peace, Remembrance of Things Past, Seven Pillars of Wisdom, and a whole conglomerate of books. And coming out the other side, half of them I didn't understand. But the fact that I had made that jump for, is very important for one's own confidence. And in the life, that is very important to get for your own identity. Mm-hmm. And people, and that's why I'm not too easy on people who've had a very good opportunity to have a very good education, that rather poo-hoo it than dismiss it.
By the time you were motoring with the Bonds, here you were with this image of this particular character. Did you, the decisions you made to choose other parts, like going to do Woman of Straw with Gina Lollobrigida, was that to play characters which were pretty well the opposite of the Bonds, or something that could express yourself a bit more than a slightly straight-jacketed character?
Yeah, without question. I mean, the problem was that the limitation of time on my part, or rather being able to offer myself or my services for a film, really imposed limitations. Something like The Hill, which is a 7-week picture, I did get that in, but then the others were back to back, and I found myself doing you know, two films at once, dubbing and looping at night and doing the other film during the day and probably picking up the other shots at the weekend.
Yes. The hill in which you play the RSM who's been court-martialed and, like others, some die, has to run up and down this hill and be bullied generally by Sergeant Major, I think it was Harry Andrews, was it? Did you want to play the Sergeant Major part originally in that?
Yeah, that's right. When I read it, in fact, I had lunch a couple of times with Sidney Lumet. We've done now four films together, but I didn't honestly believe that an American could make a film about the British Army or the British Services, because I don't think, or I didn't think, that they would be totally conversant with it, because it's really quite different. And, of course, on the rare occasion, I was wrong again. But because he made an extremely good film, very well cast and everything, but people tend to forget that film was a total failure.
It got good critical reviews, but people didn't go along, did they?
Absolutely, like a few others, one knows.
What kind of a soldier are you?
I'm a live one, unless Williams has got other plans for me.
Discipline. The arm is run on discipline.
I'm a regular soldier because I couldn't get a bloody job in Civvy Street. But I was a good toy, clockwork soldier, just like you are. You throw an order at me and I could pick it up like a dog picks up a bomb.
On your feet and you listen.
No, I don't listen! Bloody years that there's a people are just fighting underpaid gunmen, that's who we are.
Treason? You're talking treason?
Right!
Get on your feet!
Okay, treason. That's power 531, section 7. Any person committing any traitorous or mutinous practice may be sentenced to penal servitude for the term of his natural life.
Are you crazy?
All right. All I know is that I can't do things that don't make sense to me anymore. You can still live by the book. But it's out of date, it's stupid and out of date.
Oh, you quit, eh? Glass house permanent for the rest of the war.
Right.
When you're choosing your scripts, and you must be sent many, people in America, John Wayne used to, perhaps Eastwood does now to an extent, with your eminence in the business, very often have, if not a political point, a specific philosophical point to make in the material they choose to use. Do you? Can you see that continuity through your films in the 70s and early 80s?
Yeah, but more in retrospect than at the time of choosing. I wasn't so aware of it until afterwards. In fact, I was talking with a chap from The Guardian today who was talking about this kind of Puritanism, Scottish Puritanism, that runs through the parts and things, and then the choice. And it's very difficult to see why you choose a part and why you don't. And let things go as one has done. As I say, my response is immediately to what I think is good writing. I certainly have an opinion. I mean, I think that, like, for example, on Outland, Peter Himes wrote the screenplay, and he came down to Spain, and we sat and talked about it, and it was so kind of clear cut. The guy was so smart and so decisive and everything that my argument against that with Peter was that he would have been running the station. Why was he the kind of third-rate cop who had been chased from one planet to the other, as it were?
Yes, because he exposes corruption in the system. People are being fed drugs to work harder that ultimately kill them.
Yeah, and so the person would have been less assured than he was written in that kind of black and white way. That's one of the points. But then that's kind of shading in terms of what you want to do with a part. But I suppose, in answer to your question before, I chose it because of the sort of morality of it. I like the fact that that you can resolve a problem and be able to do something about it, because I hate parasites. I hate incompetence and I hate stupidness. And that sort of corruption. I like to think that, well, sometimes the good guys win.
Part of your deal, I think, on Diamonds Forever was also that you could make a film of your own choosing, and you chose a play by John Hopkins.
Yeah.
Why was that? It wasn't to make further commercial gains, necessarily, was it?
No, it was. I was of the opinion at the time that you could make pictures for $1 million. It would be good films, and I had been interested in the subject. It was called then something like The Truth, a stage play that John had written, and we'd worked on a few other projects and I got Sidney Lumet, and we made the story, not this story, yours, it was them. We had to change the title, so we called it The Offense. That was really for America, to accommodate it. But it's a, it never was going to be a film that they, was going to be a blockbuster or anything. It was obviously going to be a very serious subject about a policeman who's really can't handle the job anymore because he has no other side to his life. He has no home life, really. He has no relationship with his wife. And so the it's just a disintegration of getting into his head. And I don't think that one you see many films about that particular subject. And it didn't, as you didn't make a penny.
She'll be fine. Right as ninepence. In a couple of days, you won't know the difference. Looking at her, she'd be as good as new.
Isn't that something to be grateful for?
Just, she isn't new. Good as new. She can't be, not again. He's been there. He's had her. And what's the matter?
She's alive.
But she could be dead. Oh, I've seen them dead. A couple of years ago, remember? That girl, the bloke that he tore her in half, what was her name? The dark hair. I can see her, but I can't. I can't keep everything here. All the people, the things, the death. Bodies. Stinking, swollen, black, putrid, and the smell of the death.
I read that you accepted Woman of Straw sight unseen, but exceptionally, you didn't accept Marnie from Alfred Hitchcock when he rang you up and said, do a movie, which is most unusual. Was Hitchcock miffed that you wanted to read the script? Because people normally
yes,
just
he
say,
was. Yeah, he said that normally it was sufficient that he had offered the script, and I said, well, it's... Well, I have to play it, so I'd like to read it, because, you know, I could end up playing... Bambi or something.
How did you get on with Hitch? I mean, did he talk much to actors? Did he explain a lot to you?
No, he never. I think he only gave me two directions all the time we made the film. It was very humorous and very. We had to do many retakes because he was producing and directing, and we had internal problems. But to do more with the blue screen, which is, you know, trying to do back projection and more technical problems than anything else. One time, I have a bad habit of when I'm listening to somebody, with my whole attention, my mouth opens. And I didn't realize I was doing it in a take, and he said that he didn't think anybody in the audience would be interested in my dental work. So, and then I also have a habit of when I'm a bit up in a scene, I tend to talk too quickly, and... after the take, he said, well, I think we will go one more time and perhaps we'll inject some dog's feet, which meant pauses. And, and apart from that, nothing. He was terrific.
In the mid-70s, beginning with the film The Wind and the Lion, the John Milius film where you play this Sultan of the Berbers, you chose to play larger and more romantic roles. Was that something that you instantly warmed to?
Well, the writing of something always grabs me. Mm. And I mean, I think John Milius is an exceptional writer. I think he's a better writer than he is a director. And the film, I think, is very, very good and would have been really... a fantastic movie with a different director. But the appeal of The Wind and the Lion for me was that it was such a great story about this character, and it was also based on a real person in the Lords of the Atlas, the books about Raizuli. And to put him in that setting against Hoover in America, that was just a terrific combination. And we shot the entire film in Spain.
Almeria, was it?
Oh, everywhere. We were in Almeria, Madrid, Matas Las Cañas, which is on the Atlantic coast, and Jerez, and, oh, God knows where.
But equally, within that sort of larger-than-life romantic period, you did The Man Who Would Be King, directed by John Huston, who I think initially wanted Humphrey Bogart and Clark Gable. Is that true?
Well, yeah, because he'd been waiting 27 years to do it. He just kept working at it and working at it. I mean, it was for an actor, and Michael Caine would agree with me that it was, you know, just a dream. In fact, it's interesting, it's quite difficult stuff because you can't mess around, you can't miss a couple of words and paraphrase because of how it's structured. And it's only in, if you read the text, you'll see what one means.
Is it true that Caine and you blocked out the scenes together, in fact? I mean, there was, you invented your own tango as to how you were going to move through the parts.
Well, we didn't dance very much together.
I was using it as a metaphor.
No, joking aside, it's true. We went off and worked with... I enjoyed that very much, and we did all the throne scenes, and because we had the most marvelous locations on the picture. We had a very, very good art director, which is very important on these movies. Having said that, of course, I immediately forgot his name.
Any Towner, experts?
Towner, Alex, Alex Towner.
Yes.
Very, very good. Cut the top of a mountain, built this Kafiristan and everything. So it was a great... without finding something to do or react to.
Yes. Because in the Kipling book, your character, Danny, I mean, he embarks with Michael Caine to take over this state in order to rob them. And then he begins to think he really is a descendant of Alexander the Great. It's a form of interior madness. Did you play it like that?
Well, yeah, I mean, it's a morality tale. You know, you mess around with the gods and they fix you. You know, he contested with Imbra, and Imbra's, of course, the other, the Freemasons aspect about it. I mean, I think it's an amazing story. It's only 22 pages as a short story, and how complete it is interesting in that we found at one stage Huston wanted to change the scene with Michael and I. There was a girl comes in and starts, he's lying down, she starts wafting her sarong and she's got nothing on underneath, so then he's lying there and I'm outside drilling the troops, of course, the good part. And well, originally it was the other way around. He was out drilling the troops. In fact, I think he was much better than I was because he was much funnier, if you remember the film. But Huston wanted to change that. And so we changed it. And there was another part we changed. And when we talked about it, he said it wouldn't matter what he changed in the film because the way he'd conceived it with Gladys Hill was of one person, the one man. And therefore, the one half complemented the other. And that's why the relationship worked so well.
What, may I ask, did you think you were playing at? Charging the enemy single-handed?
I got carried away. Here at the moment, the blood was up.
Acting like some green lieutenant hoping to be mentioned in dispatches. A man of your age.
Sorry.
You ought to be ashamed of yourself.
Sorry.
Supposing you got killed, eh? Supposing that, where would I be at?
Won't happen again.
See, it don't. And what'd you carry that arrow around for?
No particular reason.
I've never seen anything like it all my life.
Come on, laddie, back! What's she up to?
What would that jackaroo do?
Huh?
Jackaroo!
And then we're imps! I'm Basal! And I'm Utsichir! Then I'm a Tilmarake Kibira Batal! And then Ketalu Mirrach Rash!
He's a he great warrior. He win this big battle. And now, according to custom, he lop off their heads.
Great warrior, eh? Well, I never saw him in the thick of the fray.
There'll be no execution of prisoners in this army. Time to put that sword away.
And the third of that trio of historical characters, and Robin Hood and Robin and Marion, couldn't have been further from James Bond. I mean, Robin is down and out. When you read the James Goldman script, was it Richard Lester who sent it to you? Any hesitation?
Oh, no. I think that Robin and Marion, in fact, is on a par with The Man Who Would Be King as a complete script. And it's... rather sad that the picture was not a success at all, but it has become a success in terms of, I don't know why, but it's been sort of resurrected as a semi kind of cult movie now, very quickly, quicker than any of the others. Like, say, The Hill took much longer to come about. But Goldman wrote the story but completely. I think he captured everything about it. But I think they made one fatal error in exploiting the film by trying to make it a romantic story. The film was written by Goldman as the death of Robin Hood and should have been left as that, because that's what he was examining, the sort of death of a hero, and revealing, really, that he's not too intelligent, you know, Robin. In fact, he's the smart one, really, is the sheriff of them all. He's the one with the intelligence, which was Robert Shaw. And to expose it in that way, it starts off quite sort of jolly, and then eventually the reality of the tale prevails, and you realize that, my God, it's about somebody who's really over the hill, who's not too smart, who's a boy at heart with some kind of charisma, and I'm sure that's how it was, and makes heroes.
We'll have a time in the forest. You'll tend me till I'm well again. And then, great battles. We'll have a life to sing about. My legs are cold.
I know.
And now?
I said you'd have no pain.
What have you done? John! You're poisoned! Help me!
No one can help you now.
Jesus, Marion.
And now is a time where perhaps one or two people from the floor would like to put their points.
I'd like to ask you, of all the characters you've played over the years, which is the one that's most like yourself? The real Sean Connery.
Well, probably a mixture of Robin and Marion and Dravot and the man who would be king.
Do you particularly like James Bond, or do you just find him a bloody nuisance?
Do I particularly like James Bond, or just find him a bloody nuisance? I have to say, I don't dislike him.
In terms of your career, now, did you go back to the part just because you felt you had to further your career, or did you go back because you really wanted to?
Well, that's a different question. No, I don't have that sort of strategy in terms of my career. I have to say that I decide entirely upon the response I have to what I read. Regardless of the results, and I think it justifies itself with the amount of failures that run in terms with the amount of successes. I don't know if I answer your question.
I think so. This man just... Yes. Sir.
Why do you think you were originally chosen to act as James Bond in the very beginning?
Why was I chosen to play James Bond? Well, there's a couple of reasons. First of all, Ian Fleming himself had the right to choose who was going to play the part. And the budget dictated greatly who it was going to be. And it was a real hot race between Cary Grant and me. And if they got me for 6,000, I was a winner.
You had a reputation for moving well, didn't you?
I'm a very good mover.
It's a man waving a pamphlet just over there.
Yeah, I'd like to quote to you, Mr. Connery, if I may, from this magazine. This is the Sean Connery Appreciation Society, of which I have the pleasure of running myself. thought I'd throw the plug in. It's an interview by Robert Ward in Spain, Marbella, where you live. And he asked you, of all your female co-stars, who was your most sexiest co-star in a film? And you said, by far, Michael Caine in The Man Who... Is that still true?
That is perfectly true. And he is a good mover.
probably rather a trivial question, but I wondered what on earth made you actually wear a hairpiece for the last film you did?
Well, my hair is trivial, I admit. Well, believe it or not, but it was a point of great discussion during the pre-production of the film, whether one went with a beard or a moustache or a hairpiece or whatever. I mean, one used it because it was a James Bond film, and whereas on other films, like, say, on Robin and Marion or The Man Who Would Be King or whatever, one didn't need it because it didn't seem appropriate. Orient Express, I did, because one was looking for a certain line and a look.
And a final question, that other eternal youth, Roger Moore. Older than you. When he goes to see Never Say Never Again, what do you hope his reaction will be?
Well, I don't know. Perhaps he's seen it. I think Roger's in Gestad, and it's... maybe he couldn't get in. It's very busy in Switzerland. But, he probably thinks maybe Sean moves better than I do. And, I do have more hair than he has. I am older than he is. What age do you get your pension in this country?
65 if you're a man.
Who's going to answer questions on Sean Connery? First of all, please look at this clip.
My guitar's out. Now